Hello everyone, this is Dennis and you are on the Den Electro channel. Today we will be assembling a powerful linear power supply with fairly good voltage stabilization, but at the same time a simple circuit and a minimum number of parts. In addition to these advantages, the power supply has short circuit protection. The power supply voltage is adjustable from 2 to 20 volts, and the maximum current will be 5 amperes. The power supply uses the following diagram. On the left, you can supply from 40 to 25 volts to the input. On the right at the output, we will receive a stabilized low voltage, about 20 volts. The output voltage depends on the Zener diode ZD1. In my case, a D815D Zener diode with a voltage of 11.2 volts was used. The higher its voltage, the higher the output voltage. The voltage is regulated using a 3.3 kilo-ohm variable resistor R4. Transistors Q1 and Q2 KT805 pass the entire load current through themselves. They are controlled by a cascade of transistors Q3 and Q4. To increase current flow and power dissipation, transistors Q1 and Q2 are connected in parallel. At the output of such a power supply, you can get a current of up to 10 amps, but everything will depend on the power of the transformer. Therefore, I plan to receive no more than 5 at the output. I made the board for the power supply from cardboard. I pasted the location of all the parts on top and the tracks on the bottom. I made holes in the places marked with dots and inserted all the parts there. After assembly, we got this cool power supply. Although, of course, I tried to use all the Soviet parts, I still didn't have any high-capacity capacitors, so I had to use a couple of foreign ones. On the reverse side, I connected all the parts with bare copper wires. In places where a large current will pass, you need to use thicker wires. The radiator is not too big. With airflow for such power of the power supply, it should be enough. If you don't have a fan, then take a larger radiator. The diode bridge for the power supply will also be assembled from Soviet diodes. I used 2D202D diodes. There are 8 of them, 2 diodes in parallel. Each of them can withstand 5 amps. Thus, the total current of this diode bridge will be 10 amperes. The power supply will be powered from a Soviet transformer with a power of 90 watts. This is a very good thing, but for my power supply it is still weak. Although I connected some windings in parallel to increase the current to the maximum, it can only produce 5 amps without overheating. And even at maximum load, the voltage will not stand still and will begin to sag significantly. In the future, for permanent operation, it will need to be replaced with something more powerful. Now you can conduct the maximum load test. This pointer ammeter will show the current at the input of the power supply. This multimeter has input voltage after the diode bridge. I will load the power supply with an electronic load. On its LED display, we will monitor the voltage and current consumption. The voltage at the output of the power supply is now minimal, 2.4 volts. Then I will increase the current and watch how the voltage sags. Unfortunately, at such a low voltage, my electronic load was only able to load the power supply at 3.7 amps. At the same time, the voltage dropped by 0.2 volts. To compensate for the drawdown, the regulator can be twisted and the voltage increased. Now the voltage is 2.5 volts and the current has also increased, more than 6 amperes. If the load is removed, the voltage rises to 3.2 volts. Now I will raise the voltage to 5 volts. At 2 amperes, the voltage dropped by 0.2 volts. At 4 by 0.4. And at 5 at 0.6 volts. I'll turn the knob and increase the voltage. I'll do it as it was without a 5-volt load. If the load is removed, the voltage increases to 5.5 volts. I'll raise the voltage to 10.4 volts. At 2 amperes, it became 10.2. At 4, it is exactly 10. And at 5 amperes, 9.9 volts. I'll increase the load some more. The current can be made more than 5 amperes. But at the same time, the voltage already begins to sag significantly. At 8 amps, the voltage becomes 9.5 volts. At 10 amps, the voltage drops to 8.8 volts. I'll try to raise the voltage as it was, up to 10 volts. Everything works. The load at the output of the power supply is quite decent, 100 watts. The radiator is already hot, but it doesn't burn your hand. If you remove the entire load, the voltage rises to 12 volts. Now the same thing, but with 15 volts. At 3 amps, the voltage dropped by 0.4 volts. With a current of 5 amps, the voltage becomes 14.5 volts. To compensate for the drawdown, I also turn the regulator. I'll increase the current some more. At 10 amps, the voltage drops to 12.7 volts. And even if you turn the regulator, the voltage still does not rise above 13 volts. For my transformer, this is already the maximum load. At the end, I will set the almost maximum voltage to 20 volts. At 2 amperes, the voltage dropped by 0.3 volts. At 3 by 0.6. Even if you turn the regulator higher, the voltage still does not rise, since the input voltage has also already dropped significantly. The difference between the input voltage and the output voltage is very small. With a current of 5 amps, the voltage becomes slightly less than 18 volts, but the load is still decent, almost 100 watts. With a further increase in current, the voltage drops just as much as last time, 13 volts and 10 amperes. Now let's see how short circuit protection works. The power supply is currently under load. I use a small piece of wire to short circuit the output of the power supply. After this, the unit turns off, the input voltage is restored, and the current drops to zero. If the short circuit is removed, the power supply comes back to life even under a decent load. The protection works great. There is no current consumption or overheating of parts. With a small load, the short circuit protection works in the same way. If there is no load and a short circuit occurs, sparks may fly. This occurs due to the large capacitance of the capacitors. But the protection will work just the same. I made the board size for the power supply with a reserve. thus, so that it can fit into the case of a computer power supply. From the link in the description, you can download the layout for the printed circuit board. This wiring is slightly different from the one I used to assemble my power supply. There is more distance between radio components and some inscriptions have been changed. After making the board, three jumpers will need to be made on the top side from the side of the radio components. Now they are painted white, but in the project they will be red. A variable resistor is connected to points 1, 2, and 3. The terminals of the variable resistor are marked with the same numbers in the diagram. The project file opens in the Sprint layout program. A link to it will also be in the description. Now I'll tell you a little about setting up the power supply. The total capacity of electrolytic capacitors should be taken so that 1 ampere of current consumption corresponds to a capacity of approximately 1500 microfarads. If it is more, it is even better. Otherwise, the output voltage will drop significantly, or, when a load is connected, the power supply will go into protection as if a short circuit had occurred. Transistors Q1, Q2, and Q3 can be placed on one radiator without insulating gaskets. Take the gain of all four transistors as large as possible. This is especially true for KT805 transistors. This parameter must be greater than 100, otherwise the voltage will sag even under light load. Such transistors have a very large spread in gain. It can be very small, about 10, or it can be very large, reaching up to 200. Therefore, they will have to be picked up. Keep in mind that one of the transistors can carry a maximum current of 5 amps and dissipate 35 watts. If there are two transistors, then all these parameters should double. But in practice, this will not work for everyone, since it is very difficult to find two identical transistors. I also tried to choose the same ones, but still one gets hotter than the other. At maximum voltage and high current of 10 amps, the transistors heat up approximately equally. But when the output voltage is small and the current is high, then one of the transistors begins to heat up very much, dissipating most of the power. After assembling the power supply, you need to increase the load gradually and look at the heating of each of the transistors. If you could not find two identical transistors or you do not need such power from the power supply, then one of the transistors can be removed. The Zener diode heats up noticeably during operation, so it definitely needs a radiator. In order for the Zener diode to maintain a stable voltage, a current must pass through it not lower than a certain limit. The minimum stabilization current for the D815D Zener diode is 25 milliamps. With an input voltage of 25 volts, approximately 57 milliamps of current flows through the Zener diode. But when a load is connected to the power supply, the current through the Zener diode will decrease. This happens for two reasons. The first is because the voltage on the transformer begins to sag and under load there will no longer be 25 volts. And the second is that the transistors will consume current to open. Through the variable resistor, current will flow to the base of transistor Q4. Let me demonstrate how this happens. To do this, I'll take a millimeter and connect it between the cathode of the Zener diode and the plus coming from the power supply. Everything here remains exactly the same as before. I just added this multimeter. It will just show the current flowing through the Zener diode. The current is now approximately 57 miles ampere. The voltage at the output of the power supply is 6 volts. When I increase the load current, the voltage at the input of the power supply sags, and the current through the Zener diode decreases. Now the current consumed by the load is 5 amps. At the same time, only 26 miles of ampere now flows through the Zener diode. As I said earlier, the minimum stabilization current for this Zener diode is 25 miles ampere. For any output voltage and current consumption of 5 amps, the current through the Zener diode will remain the same. After you decide what voltage you will supply to the input of the power supply and decide what maximum current you need to receive from the power supply, you need to make sure that the current flowing through the Zener diode under the load does not fall below its minimum stabilization current. The current passing through the Zener diode is selected by resistor R1. But if you make the power supply exactly the same as mine with the same parts, operating voltage and current, then you don't need to configure anything. Now I'll tell you why resistors R2 and R5 are needed. If you remove resistor R5, then the voltage can be adjusted not from 2 volts, but from 0. But the power supply circuit is designed in such a way that at such a voltage, very little energy will be stored in the capacitors at the output of the power supply. When any load is connected, the voltage there instantly decreases and the power supply goes into protection, as if a short circuit occurs. Therefore, I do not recommend doing a voltage lower than approximately 1.5 volts. Resistor R2 can also be removed and then the maximum output voltage will become slightly higher. But without this resistor, the short circuit protection will stop working at maximum voltage. If your transformer is weak, then nothing bad will happen. The output will simply have the maximum current. But if it's powerful, then you can burn all the transistors and the diode bridge. That's all for today. If you like the video, please like it, subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. Ask questions in the comments if something is unclear to someone and everyone. Bye.